Born in Bulgaria, parents are Congolese, but I grew up in South Africa. My parents were diplomats back in the day, so they used to do a lot of traveling, and it happens that I was born there. But I stayed in Bulgaria. It was still not part of the EU at the time. It was very grey, if I remember. And I was like, well, me and my family, it was like one of those black people, like, you could literally see us in the street.
Out.
Yeah. So we'll be singled out in the street. It's like you'll never see any other black person. So it was a very different, if I remember correctly, it was a different experience. I was born in 1990.
Okay.
Yeah. 3rd this March, 1990.
Is this, are the references, and your dad was a representative from the Congo.
Yes.
Are the things we read on the internet about Joseph Mobutu,
yes,
being pretty repressive and kind of stealing a lot of money from the state, basically,
yeah,
kind of destroying the democracy.
Are, yeah,
those pretty true from your perspective?
From my perspective, it's really true. And to be honest, it's just greed. It's like I have and the rest, I don't really care. So he would do things like people in politics or in the government. And it's this oppression that I have that they kind of just say, it's us against you guys. Whatever you do, we don't care. I'm the law. I do whatever I can do. Sometimes if the president is in a specific, let's say he drives down the streets, all the businesses have to close down because the president is there. So even if you're walking and the president is driving, you have to stand still to a place. If you cannot do those things, it's like a regime. Like if you can't do those things, you know, to a large extent, you don't know where you'd find yourself.
Sort of like a Nazi type.
Yes. So it's one of those things that they strive for democracy, but it's been a long shot. It got to a place where everything was corrupt. So from what I gathered, it's like because of the corruption that was happening, if they want to corrupt you and you said no, they'll think that you're better. And by doing so, you're like defining what they're trying to say. So if they say, we're going to offer you so much and we need to get that happen, if you say no because you're thinking you're doing the right thing for them, it's a no-go. So what says go?
If you want to live, you got
to you got to compromise your belief system, what you stand for. And it's just corruption everywhere. And it's Congo, it's one of the richest country in the world, and from what I've seen, it's people work around with cash. Like I've never seen a person who can walk around. I remember when I was a child, you know, people would walk around with $1 million in bags.
A lot of money because, well, I'll show my ignorance. What's,
yeah,
the resource or whatever?
Because of the minerals that we have. We pretty much, in the Congo, we have all the minerals. That's
gold,
silver, copper, diamonds, even electricity. We have the, it's weird. We have a natural generated electricity power plant that we could use that can illuminate the entire Africa, but we don't, in our own country, the Congo, there's no electricity. So they get people to invest and buy and whatever, and they take things somewhere else.
Is that because of the rich just basically taking everything?
Yes. The rich just get richer and the poor just get... So if you are wealthy in the Congo, you are extremely wealthy.
What you're telling me, it sounds like people could almost live like in Dubai.
Absolutely.
Where the state could provide an incredible... But instead, the rich people say, "Nope, we,
yeah,
want it all."
Yeah,
that's
pretty much the idea. So it's like, when I get to the top, I throw the ladder down. Nobody can climb up to the top with me. So it's me, my family, and that's it. So you get to a place where there's so much, but there's no way out. Like, if you're not strong enough, you lose yourself. You lose yourself. You lose your belief system, and you're going to get involved in things that you should not get involved into. So you just had
to
be
survive.
Strong, just to survive.
So what happens to your dad, basically has to compromise,
yeah,
to live.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden, I guess the people,
yes,
somebody, military,
mm-hmm. yeah,
somebody is building up anger,
yes,
anger.
Yes.
All of a sudden, it erupts. What year?
Yeah. So what happened was, around, if I can clearly think back.
About 95, wasn't it?
95, 96, yeah. So things went really, really, really bad.
Fast.
Like, very fast. You know, our home, you know, when everything just get taken away.
Did you guys live pretty good?
Yeah, we had a decent way of living. And my dad, because he was also involved in few things and investing some stuff, and he was one of the people that's learned to travel in Congo. In Congo, if you travel, then you see things a little bit differently, and you see the other part of the world, and you get to learn so much. So he was a well-traveled man. So he understood things, and he started investing and doing a little bit of stuff on the side, so that just in case, he knew that things were going to get bad.
He knew it was going to come to
an end. Yeah, it was going to
happen faster than
it happened very fast, to a place where our home was gone.
Tell us how this all came down.
Yeah, so I was sitting one day at home with my sibling, one of my older sister. We just saw, like, they called them aner. They just came, it's like political people. They just came and say, you guys have to be out of the house. And my dad was not there at the time. So
your dad's not aware this is going on?
No.
This is almost like Nazis.
Yeah.
Wow.
So they went there, and they pretty much just asked us to step out of the house. If we do not step out, they'll just burn the entire house
to
the ground. They'll make it happen. And all around the area, they were targeting every single person that's had any relationship with the government at the time. So
who is they?
So it's the other political party that's came in to actually, that's the Kabila people.
How did they manage? Did they get the military on
They got
side?
The military, they got the guns. So they were taking over town by town. So if they'll come there, they'll just massacre everybody, and then they take the town.
Did you see anybody killed?
Yes. I've it's terrifying to actually go back to that place where I was just a kid. I was just, I think, around eight years old. So I was young. I was pretty young to actually experience such drastic things that was happening around me. Houses getting burned down. There's gunfires everywhere. So it's one of those, you don't know what's going to happen. And I remember I got carried by our neighbor, where it was very chaotic. You know, I got carried, and one of my other family and my uncle, they were in a different town. So everything just, I cannot explain, because it happens in such a rush. And I don't know how I got to where I was to get to another place. But what I was seeing there, it was devastating. It's like, I don't know where that hatred come from. I don't know how can people treat other people the way they did.
What do you think now when you look back on it? How do people treat, why do people treat each other that way? It's like animals, right?
Yeah, and for me, I think...
Maybe worse than animals.
It's worse than animals. I think animals still have certain things that they'll abide by, but... With us people, we've been given the willpower to make decisions and to say, no, that's wrong, that's right. You know, that's what separates us from animals, in my opinion, is that if you could kill somebody, and something is definitely wrong. It's worse than animal-like, you know. So even animals still obey some rules and something. But if a person, you've got the will to do whatever it is that you got to do, it's very strange and scary.
Let me ask you this, and if this is too painful, you know, don't let me take you any place you don't want to go.
No, I understand.
But what's the most, you look back, what's the most, first of all, what's the most painful thing you witnessed?
You know, the most hurtful and the most, and if I could, I would take it back, is I've never seen my dad again. I've never got a chance to see my dad after that incident.
You left the house
until today.
You didn't see him again.
That was it.
What was the last time you saw your dad? What was the circumstance?
The last time I saw my dad, it was in the middle of the night. He just said he's going on, like it was a normal. He just
going on.
It was a goodbye, and that was it.
Was this like the day before?
Yeah. No. This happened like 3 days before.
Before
the whole thing, yeah.
Everybody shows. One second, I'm gonna move my camera and get a little different angle over here. If that's okay, have an idea for something different here on this one that I've got rolling. A little different angle on me while I'm talking to you here, if that's okay.
No, it's all right.
Okay. And if I ask anything that makes you uncomfortable, just tell me.
No, I understand.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, come on. You stay up here. Put you up there. Somewhere you'll stay up there for a minute. Keep you over here. Keep this positioned the right way here. So, was your mom at the house when this happened?
Yeah, my mom was at the house, and she got taken somewhere else. Me and my sister got taken somewhere else, and it was very chaotic. Because I was a kid, one of my neighbors actually came and picked me up. And at the time, I remember my mom was diagnosed with cancer at the time. So it was one of those things where I thought it could be treated, you know. And we are still in a place where everything was happening fast, and we were trying to make things happen. And I'm sure they were trying the best of what they could to make sure that I went to school and things like that, regardless of whatever was happening in the country at the time. Coming from a place where you could travel, and you came from a place where if there was a holiday, you guys can go to some village and be a family, and that's been taken away from you, and it's like you just get scattered, and you don't know what's gonna happen next. So, and it was very devastating. And if I could take back, is to really spend that last time and that last moment and say, I had some time with my father. You know, I would love to have that moment with my dad and my mom, you know. So after that, when I got taken away.
Hold it, thought one second.
Yeah.
One other thing here. I want to make sure
I'm all right.
Doing right. All right, I got it.
All right.
So continue that thought, if you will.
Yeah, so when I got taken away, I think those are the last time that I saw my father, and I took a last glance at my mom being pulled away, and then I had to be run off to go and see my uncle's side, which is in another city, where we went there running, walking, and I was just a little boy. So for me, it's...
must be a moment of just absolute terror.
Yeah, everything was just torn apart. Like, I cannot really explain it, but you don't know what's going to happen. I didn't even know where I was going, you know. So I had no clue. Things were burning all over the place. There were gunshots. There could have been a chance misfire and I could have been killed. If I look back, I'm forever grateful that I'm still standing. And then from there, I think my journey started to a crazy place, even crazier than what I saw and what they experienced. I've been asking where my mom was, and nobody knew. Everybody was trying to see if I could go somewhere. You know, when this family tension and a lot of family drama, so they don't know who's going to take care of who. So, yeah, in African cultures, in African African regime, the way they were brought up or whatever, so they were kind of, who's going to make the decision of where I'm going to be or where I'm going to stay?
So what do you know what happened to your parents?
Until today, I was told my father and my mom got killed.
Executed.
And who am I going, who am I gonna follow suit with that? Who am I gonna go ask? Who am I gonna speak to? I
such chaos, no record keeping. Just
nothing.
People killing each other.
They just vanish off the planet of the earth.
You have no idea where they're buried, buried.
I have no, it's, every day, if I go back to that place, I'm like, how could it be if I had my dad and my mom? How could it be if things happened in a certain way? What would it be if I was out of the country at the time? How could it be if we could just have a little bit more time, you know? So there's a lot of trivial questions that keep on happening in my head that I have no answers for.
You're how old again?
I was around 8.
So you're 8 years old. This is when kids are playing. And
yeah.
I mean, you know, at least we think in America.
Yeah.
Fun.
Yeah.
And you say your life goes. Tell me the crazy places your life goes.
From there, I didn't know. I would say I've never had a childhood at all. I don't know how it is like to play as a child. I don't know how it feels to associate yourself with other kids at some point. I had to grab life by my own hands because I did have an uncle that's really cared dearly, because the other part of my family was like, no, we're washing our hands. We don't want this kid or whatever.
Were they afraid of retaliation from the regime?
To a certain extent, but also to... I wouldn't say that was of enough of an excuse for them to not taking me in, but I think they had something against my parent, you know, in families. Maybe they were not getting along, or I don't know, but
you
that's...
think there was some jealousy over success in life?
Probably. And to a large degree, that happened. That everybody kind of washed their hands. But I had an uncle who was very close to my mom. He was doing pretty well, but he was far away from the chaos where we were. So during the time where they were figuring things out, where I was supposed to be or where I had to be, they sent me in this village. It's people that were very close to my mom. So my dad's family and whatever, until today, I don't know them. I have no idea. I don't know them. I've never met them. It was just one of those things. So my dad's side, it's like there's this emptiness. There's this wall that is just there. I have no idea what happened. I have no idea. But on my mom's side, there were still siblings that they were in a different, I would say, different city which is called Kasai Mbujimayi. It's a village.
And I should ask, all this happened, the chaos, the fire.
Yeah.
That happened in what city?
This was happening in Kolwezi.
Is that the capital? I'll show
my. No, Kinshasa is the capital DRC, Congo.
How do you spell?
Kolwezi.
How do you spell it?
Kolwezi.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how do you, you're with an uncle, how do you, you tell me you ended up in some refugee camps. How did that happen?
Yeah, this is the progression of how it's all happened. So they sent me in some village where my other family members were, or they took me in, but their life was, it's a village, you know. They were just getting by. Nobody had a job. And here I am, I'm a child. And for me to get from where I was to another village, they put me in a cargo. I don't know. There's trains, but the kind of train that I got shipped to that village. Again, God was with me, because there's this place where there's a lake. It's that bridge. It's known that. If the train goes there, anything can happen. You don't know what could happen. That train either fall into the lake and whatever, people just disappear on that lake. You don't know what happened to them. But that's the only source of, could have been the only way that they figured that they could have sent me to the village to find somebody to look after me. Then my uncle that's decided to take care of me. He was doing pretty well, and he was working for an import export company in Lubumbashi. So he was very close to my mom. When he heard, he's like, "Why would you send the child there?" and so on and so forth. So at the time, even soap, it was a problem. So I was this village boy, and I didn't know any better. And if you can see the transformation from a place where you had a roof over your head to be at the place where you eating porridge every day. You sometimes there's no soap to wash with. And I had a sister who was close to mom. She has to go out sometime. I don't know when she's gonna come back. Then when she comes back, then that's when we're gonna have our next meal. And she didn't have a job. I don't know what she had to go do or whatever the case was.
Did you have siblings?
Yes.
Was that a sister of yours?
That was my sister. And then I've got other siblings that my dad had, and I also don't know where they are.
Did they live with your family?
They lived somewhere else. So, until today, I know I've got siblings. I've got sisters from my real dad. I'm looking to go find for them. I want to get at the place where I can find them and see what's the story and understand what exactly happened.
Get the resources
that I needed, and they were much older than I was. So,
are things better in the Congo now, where you would be able to go back?
Yeah, in the Congo, it's slightly better, but there's still oppression, and there's a president who's been in power for almost 30 years. So, I don't know what's going to happen, and to just get in there, and the fact that I left Congo for when I was young. In order for me to set foot in the Congo, they'll make it like I betrayed the country.
If you went back.
If I had to go back.
So they're really, all you got was a new set of leaders. They wanted in on the greed.
Yeah.
It wasn't like they wanted to help the people.
No, not really. And if I had to go right now, there are ways that I can bypass. But if they know that I was a permanent resident of another country, it's the worst thing that could ever happen, because once I set foot in there, I'll never leave the country again.
Okay. Okay, I pulled you off your story. Your sister goes out.
Yeah.
To wait till she gets back.
Yeah, so she gets back and we get some food, and I don't know where she was getting all this. And this thing was happening so fast. And then my uncle, when he discovered that I was in that village and whatever the case was, he paid somebody else to take me up from that village to go back in Lubumbashi. He welcomed me in his home. He was doing fairly well. He was doing all right. And then my life kind of started shifting, but I was not okay. You know, there was just too much happening. But my uncle got married to another Congolese wife. When I look back, I always thank God that he's given me a heart where I forgive and I kind of forget. In that house, I saw flame, because as a young child, I had to cook. The wife is there. I had to cook. I had to sweep. I had to do, you know, I do understand there are chores and things that kids can do, but I was doing beyond what any child could do.
Or a servant.
Yeah. So I was treated like a
slave.
Like a slave in my uncle's home. But when you could tell your uncle and he would look it in your eyes and he would not believe you, you know. So I was like, this is not okay. And people from outside could see that. If you say something, if you go to school, you come back and you didn't do some chores, I'll get beaten up, like physically abused, you know. And I don't know, it's sickening thinking of the way it was. And in her mind, she strongly believed that she was disciplining me, but discipline in that way, to a place where you can break something on my body and I have bruises and I'm bleeding and stuff like that as a child, that was crazy. And I wake up the next morning, I put on my shirt, I go to school, like everything is fine. And my life started like that. And then my uncle, he got fired from his work. Then things started hitting the fan. But the thing that my uncle did, he was very close with his wife's family. His wife's family, they were very wealthy. They were doing business and whatever. They were traveling. You know, things were good. They had cars and whatever. So he became very close to his wife's family. So whatever the wife said goes. So I was at the place where I've tried to run away from that house, going where I don't know. I've tried so hard, but it's never happened. I'll try, and then they'll come pick me up somewhere else and whatever. But it was a continuous process. Mm-hmm. It was a never-ending situation. So my uncle got fired. He saved some money, and he said he was going to go look for a better life somewhere elsewhere. And I was scared that my uncle is leaving, because I don't know what was going to happen to me with his wife, you know. So my uncle left and he went to seek refuge in South Africa.
He did or you did?
No, my uncle. He left to go to South Africa first to go see what was going on and whatever. He went there because he had some cash saved up. But when he arrived in South Africa, in Johannesburg, the crime rate at that time, it was very high. It was like over the top. He left his stuff in some hotel, because in Congo, people travel with dollars. No cards, no bank cards, nothing. All the money that he had, all of it, he lost it in South Africa. He had no choice but stay in South Africa. Well, you went to report to say there's nothing. You either go back to Congo where things are horrible, you don't have a job, and he had his friends and whatever, they were also doing okay. So he was at the place where he didn't know what to do. He was like, let me see. Because in the Congo, when they know that you're overseas and whatever, they think you're living better. You've got everything, you know, everything is possible for you or whatever the case is. So he kind of looked at that as an opportunity for him to stay in South Africa, but with nothing. But he had some other friends that he knew in South Africa at the time. So he started doing car wash from a businessman who had his house, who had cars, who'd been traveling. There was nothing else you could do in South Africa but do car wash. And it's not even car washing, no, car watch. So when you go in a set, like a mall, yeah. So he watched the cars and he would get coins. And those coins is the money that he saved, $100 that he felt like, if I could get an education somewhere else, something could be better, and maybe I could help his children someday or some.
If he could get you.
Yeah, if he could get me. Wow. So he saved up $100. He gave somebody $100 who knew how to get somebody into a country illegally. So this guy came, and I was staying at the wife's family's house. Everything was okay. There were some children there, but I was like, I was just this kid who just I'm lost with everything.
In South Africa?
I'm still in the Congo.
Okay.
So this guy came to South Africa and asked that they gave him $100 to bring me to South Africa. South Africa and Congo, it's not 1 million miles away, but due to the process or the route that we were going about it, because there was no money, it would take me 3 months on the road in order for me to enter South Africa. Wow. And I was excited. I was like, to a certain degree, I was not getting along with this woman. I've lost everything, and I'm depressed. I'm sad. I'm just, for me, any opportunity, I was like, wow, I'm going to South Africa. I didn't care which route I was gonna make it in South Africa. I just knew that I'll get to South Africa. So I told some of the people from school, no, I'm traveling. I'm excited and so on and so forth. But that journey of me coming from the Congo to South Africa, it took 6 months on the road. Now, this guy took the $100, he's gone. He said it took me from Congo to the border of the border between Congo and Zambia. So I was in a truck. I was a child. I think I was around 11 at the time. Yeah, 11, 11, 12.
You're on your own.
No, he gave me the bag. This is the way we had to cross this borders.
Okay.
So I had my small backpack with some clothes in it. I had to get out the truck because he has got the paperwork. He's got the documentation.
I got you.
So
you've got to slip in around the other
way
and
meet
him on the other side.
There we go. So I take my bag.
You're an illegal immigrant.
There we go. So I took my bag. I walk. And I was 11 years old at the time. Walk with my bag. Got to the other side of the border. He didn't have money. And he didn't care. They gave him $100. So whatever, if it's crumbs that I'm going to eat till I get there, that's what I'm going to have. I spent the whole night sleeping, starving to death. I was hungry. I've never been hungry like that, where I could see somebody just eating even an apple. I'll beg to have something. It was hard. we took another bus. We went to another place called Livingstone. Livingstone, it's another city in Zambia. Again, he put us in some room. He left. And now in Livingstone, there was other women that their husbands kind of paid the money so they can get to. So in that presence of those women, I became like their child, and they started, you know, if they buy something, they'll give me a little something to eat. Yeah, it was a constant struggle, because $100, it was not a lot of money. I think by the time that I got to Zambia, that was it. So they started, if they'll eat something, they'll get me some, and so on and so forth. We eventually continued the journey. We got to Botswana. Again, same procedure. I had to get my bag walking. I don't know what could have happened to me. If I had to disappear, I don't know what was going to happen. It's a place where I don't know. I couldn't speak a word of English. And they gave me a. So they created this, I think it's a fake passport or something, when we got to the border of Botswana. And they told me, if they ask you what's your name, I didn't know that you say Peter the way we say it, Peter. In French, you say Peter. So I had to learn how to say Peter in English, so that when they ask me, I know that I sound like Peter. So we did a practice run and so on and so forth. We crossed the border of Botswana, and we managed to go through. And that time, all the borders were pretty much closed, border patrol and so on and so forth. We started to go seek refuge in Namibia, because Namibia was close to South Africa. Now, that journey to go from Botswana to Namibia, you can't go through the borders. It's an English country, and they are very strict. They obey the law, everything. So there's nothing else you could do. I had to follow. I didn't have anything. He's got the papers. This guy who had to take me and the women and whatever. Now, there's one, two guys that didn't have papers. We literally had to walk in the forest from. I've never walked, until today, I've never walked that long in my life. There were lions, crocodiles. You don't know what's gonna happen. And he said, when you get to that specific place, you gotta ask the village people, you gotta give them so much so that they can put you in this little boat. There's hippopotamus in that lake. You could see helicopters going around. It's like things that you see in the movies. I've lived that.
Hippopotamus in the lake,
In a lake.
helicopters overhead watching for anybody.
Anybody who's trying to cross the border illegally.
Wow.
And I'm this 11-year-old boy just following the guys. I don't know if a lion, and you are warned, there are signs everywhere.
About lions.
Lions, they are beast animals that are out there. So I just, again, I was protected. God protected me. We eventually got to this village where this guy had done it quite a lot, so those village people know that there are some people that are doing this. And then when we got to that village, we had to cross. I think it's like a box this big. So if there's more people, you guys are gonna sink. And then there are crocodiles and things in the lake.
No life jackets, I'm sure.
Even my bag that I had, I didn't have to carry a bag anymore. I left everything. I don't have a bag anymore. So this is me, just the way I am, trying to get to the other side of the world. Then I got to that village. They gave me bread, and I think it's some insect that they eat. It's insect, but they do it with some spice. I don't know. It's stuff that we see like in the crazy. It's like the way they spice those things. They had to keep it cool under the lake so it can get cooler and stuff like that. So I had to sit there with some village people. We sit around the fire. I think it was a different experience. At least I had some warm food. They put like a mat outside around the fire, so we kind of blend in as the village people. Therefore, they couldn't. Even if cops had to come there, we were part of the village. So we had to spend at least 3 weeks to wait for another boat that will come so that we can cross on the other side. So we just cross one side and we have to take another boat to cross on the other side. So we waited for 3 weeks. In that 3 weeks, not washing, it's the village, nobody cares, nobody knows you, it's whatever. So whatever, if nobody give you something, you are there, you can't do anything. And it was the most nastiest, and it was crazy the way it was. It was cold. I started having like rashes on my body, and it was just very uncomfortable. It's something that I wouldn't wish upon my worst enemy, yeah, for something like that to happen. I cannot describe it. And
so you finally get across, though.
Yeah.
And you end up in South Africa.
I finally got across.
With your uncle?
No, I was not with my uncle.
I mean, when you got there.
Oh, when I got there, then my uncle, he was in Cape Town. Now, from Cape Town, from Johannesburg to Cape Town, you have to travel again. So you had to ask somebody else to get me on the train. But South Africa, it was the developed country in the thing.
Are you giving money to somebody, or is this?
Yeah.
Just...
Okay. He called somebody like, listen, there's a kid, they're gonna drop him at Park Station, which is the most popular station in Johannesburg. It's gonna look like so and so. Please go look around. They said he didn't even know when I was arriving. He just say, just look around. If you see him around this time, and that guy that they gave $100, he's already in Cape Town. Yeah. He's already gone. So now I'm coming with people that from one place, this one dropped me in that hand, that one dropped me in this hand. So it's total confusion. I don't know.
At any point, somebody could have just gone back with him.
Yes.
You're just fortunate.
Yeah, I was fortunate.
That everybody along the way did what they said. They didn't abandon me. Wow.
So that's why sometimes I look at my life, I'm like, I was protected ever since I was a gaff. I was a little child. Then somebody in Park Station, when they told him, oh, he's been in on the road for so long, he bought KFC. He bought me a loaf of bread and some chicken.
KFC.
Yeah. Kentucky Fried Chicken. Yeah. That's the best thing that I have never eaten in a long time.
Best meal you ever had.
So I got a loaf of bread. Now, the train that we are supposed to take, that's the only thing I had. So the train that I took took about 24 hours to get to Cape Town. Obviously, in the cheapest condition possible, they gave me like a box of juice. So I had to manage the way I eat that thing along that 24 hours. Yeah, but I was very hungry. So when I got that meal, I finished everything. I finished everything, and the past 14 hours, I don't know, the people next to you, they're eating, and you don't know what to say. Just sit down there and just watch, or I just fall asleep. And eventually, I got to Cape Town, and my uncle was there. That was... the best feeling, like at least there's somebody that I know.
He didn't abandon you.
He didn't abandon me.
He was there. To spend $100.
Yeah.
Wow.
Is and he was there struggling in South Africa. His family, the rest of the family is still in the Congo. His wife and his two children, two daughters. They were
this
still.
This is the same uncle who looked the other way when you were being abused and treated as a slave.
Yeah.
But at least in the end, he...
He welcomed me.
He welcomed
now
you.
It gets better. It gets more interesting. I go to South Africa. Now, you were staying with other people. Now, that house where you were staying, they've got very strict laws. We refugees. You cannot have more than certain amount of people in the house. I thought I was going to stay with my uncle. In my imagination, I was thinking like, okay, my uncle is in South Africa. He's probably got a job. He's got a car and stuff like that. But no, he was sleeping on the floor in South Africa, doing car wash. So to a large degree, that $100 that he put forth, and I feel like I owe him so much. Because I am where I am because of that $100 that he spent.
Are you still in touch with him?
Yeah, he's the person that's... The story gets better.
Yeah, he's been through hell.
You know, so this story gets interesting. So I got to South Africa. In my head, I think I was going to stay with my uncle. But no. He had to ask another family to stay with me. Now, that family, it's our own brothers, and sometimes it's sickened me, like, how do we treat each other like that?
It was your own brother, you said?
No, like, we were from the same country.
Oh, okay, I got you.
I was just one child. I'm not going to eat the entire house. You can just feed me a meal, just one meal per day. But no. I was sleeping in the couch. They would make food. But my uncle, the coins that he was making, he had to pay like per week. He had to pay like $20.
For you to eat.
For me to eat and sleep.
Wow. This was quite a sacrifice.
Yeah. So he had to pay that money for me.
You'll pardon me for a second for thinking. And I know you're new to this country.
Yeah.
Of even thinking of myself grow up or see kids now grow up, and their biggest concern is whether they're going to have unlimited data on their cell phone.
Yeah.
That's their big worry.
That's the big worry.
Jeez. Yeah. You're worried about just whether you can have one meal a day.
One meal a day.
Wow.
That's something. And for me, I was like, I don't know, there was this thing that was always embedded in me that I will be successful someday. Someday I'll become better. And this is me not speaking a word of English. In South Africa, it's an English country.
Are you still depressed at this point?
At this point, I'm still miserable.
But you're still hopeful.
I'm still hopeful.
Where's that come from?
For me, I wish I had the answers to that. But it's just my strong belief. When I was in the Congo, I'll call it my stepmother or my uncle's wife. Her family used to go to church a lot. So I used to sing just to kind of let it go. And I'll sing gospel songs. And whenever I sing, I put myself in a good place. And I was a child, but I could sing. And I'll sing gospel songs. And I think that's where there was just something that's, I can't give up. I just couldn't give up. So it's one of those things. Until today, I'm like, the reason why I love to share my story and I would like to write about it is to just also say that circumstances does not make us. It's kind of reveals us of who we should become. I think I make wiser and good decisions now because I went through hell. And I'm still here trying to seek for a place to do better, to help my siblings, to regardless of whatever have happened in my past. I think that's why I say God has given me a heart to forgive and forget.
So how do you get from South Africa to 2 months ago ending up in America?
Yes. It was, I played the lottery. Normally,
in
South Africa, yeah. So during the process of what was happening and whatever, there was a lot of growth, a lot of transformation, and a lot has happened within South Africa. Then the family joined, my uncle's family joined. Again, we went back to the same routine. We got a small box. I was working at the age of 15 to put the food on the table. They had little girls. At the time when they came, I learned how to speak English by watching Days of Our Lives every day on TV.
It worked.
Then I went to primary school. I think I was...
That's too funny.
Yeah. I went to primary school and I was thinking that I was this boy and in the Days of Our Lives. So I started using, like, speaking normal, like learning how to speak. I think they call it grade 7. I don't know, 7th grade. I don't know if it's the same in America. But from there, I started working at the age of 15. Wow. I was cleaning in a restaurant again. I was sweeping. I'll go work, come back at night, do my homework, bring food from the shop. So whatever money I'll make, I'll go straight to the shop and buy food. And we can eat. And we were living, I don't know, this room is quite big.
It was smaller than this room.
It's smaller than this room. Literally, when you open, I think, I don't know if the pantry, when you open, that's the toilets. In that little area right there, that's where it was like a sleeping mattress and whatever way I'd sleep with this other cousin of ours who sleep there. And then in the next room, then that's my uncle and his wife. He'll sleep there with his girls. So it's became, so my uncle will go to work to go obviously get money for some rent, and I'll go to school and go to work to get some food. And sometimes I'll go to school where they could give us some free food or bread or whatever. I can't miss a day at school, so that I need to take that stuff and I won't eat it. And I'll hold on to it until I get home and share it with the rest of my siblings. And then through the process, things started getting better. That's why I keep on saying I had the favor and the grace of God always on my side. Through cleaning the restaurants and whatever, they made me a server. To a place, and by serving, I just had a positive attitude to whatever I was doing. After becoming a server, I was serving a guest. That's why I love the industry so much, the hospitality industry, because that's the only thing I knew. I was going to school with broken shoes. I was going to school with no food. I was going to school with nothing at all. And sometimes you see other kids, they'll come pick them up, and you have to play sport. You gotta have sport gear, and I didn't have it. Sometimes I would love to play sport, but I don't have sport tennis shoes to play sport. So I have to watch other kids play sport. And for me, it was like, it's like my suffering went ahead and continued in South Africa. So I didn't know nothing about being a child at all. Until today, I still don't know. I had to provide. I had to make the right decisions. I had to to do things so I can improve myself every day. So I went to high school. Then high school, primary school, my fees were not paid up. So I was a bad person, like a bad child. And my uncle couldn't speak English. I made the effort to speak English, but he couldn't. He was still struggling. He was older, but he was still struggling to speak English. So who was going to pay my fees? Nobody.
He wasn't watching Days of Our Lives.
He was not watching Days of Our Lives. He was not watching Days of Our Lives. And sometimes they'll have parent meetings. He never attends. So in that sense, they were doing what they knew best. At the same time, I was being a parent. So I went to school. There was this teacher of mine. I was good in maths, but my other subject, I was doing fairly okay because of the language and so on and so forth. After I finished my seventh grade, I was supposed to go to high school. She wrote a letter of recommendation to the high school. She gave me, she said she was going to pay my first semester, a lecture, the teacher. She said she will pay the first semester, but they have to take me to a high school. Because if they can't, she doesn't know what I could do. You know, because I was suffering. You could even see that this child is literally suffering. Then they accepted me at the high school and working every day. I work, I go home, wash dishes, do the same thing over and over again. But I always say people do what they know best. And I think that's kind of gave me a sense of just let go easily. Like, you know, they think they know what they know best. You know, so I got at the place where I don't look back to what they were doing. I want to do better so I can help them see things differently. So until today, every little success that I have, they are the most proud people ever, but they forget sometimes what I had to go through during the process of being at the place where I am today. So high school again, they made me a server. As a server, I was studying, working hard. You know, I started becoming aware of certain things. I started reading a lot of motivational books. I think that's where I got inspired. You know, there's an author, Earl Nightingale. There's another one, Think and As a Man Think Of by James Allen. They say, your thoughts becomes a reality to a large degree. And I just started thinking in a positive and hopeful way, regardless of what I was facing at the time. High school, everybody's looking good to school and whatever. And here I am. I had to go buy my uniform. I had to go buy it from the children that's left school long time ago. So it's my uniform was very washed out. I had to buy secondhand shoes. Because the money that I was making in a restaurant, it was
food.
It was just food and making sure that I helped the rest of the house. Sometimes I'll go to school, I won't even have deodorant, you know. So I became uncomfortable and it's hot. Sometimes because you want to make sure that things at least are okay at home, you get to a place where I had to steal trains to go to school. So sometimes they'll put me in a train. I'll get on a train. Then there's security guards. They'll throw me out of the train. Then I have to walk a couple of miles to go to the next station, take another train, ride along again and praying to God that I don't get stopped until I get to school. And if it's raining, I go to school, I'm wet. And it's exams time. Sometimes if I don't work, then there's no food. If I don't do this, then I'm going to have a little problem for the people that's that taking care of me or my uncle's wife and whatever. But to a large degree, she's, despite everything she've done, she kind of molded me to do things better.
But you're not being beaten at this point.
No, I'm not getting beaten at all. I think they stopped beating me up at when I was, I think, 17. 17, that's where I was like, you can't do this though. It's. When I was in South Africa, the journey continued. I was being beaten. And I'll have to lie to school why they were beating me up. I'll say I knocked myself somewhere. And then if I had to wash the dishes, or before I go to school in the morning, and this is high school, I have to make sure that the entire house is clean. And then if it's not clean, or I say something like, I'll do it when I get back, or whatever the case was. And this is the woman that was, you know, she was there at home most of the time, you know. If I defy whatever she was saying, I'll find my clothes packed in a box. Say, you're no longer going to stay here. She've done that a couple of times. It's became like a sing and dance.
But she finally got big enough where you could say, this ain't happening.
No, I was like, you can't do this. Next time you say, I must go, I'm never coming back. I think at the age of 18, 19, I moved out.
Yeah.
Because it was a progressive thing. I felt like I was being manipulated to a large degree. And
do your own cleaning.
Yeah, so I was at the place at 18. Things started happening in my life. As a server, I met another guest. They said, you look nice on camera. So from there, I went to my very first TV commercial campaign.
English?
English.
Wow.
English.
Days of our lives.
Days of our lives. Days of our lives. So this lady, I served her, and we were just chatting. She's like, I've got a modeling agency. Would you care to come and see us?
You're a good looking guy.
Thank you. So I went there. I didn't have clothes. I went there walking. I was sweating. But when you walk into the place, you see the pictures of the guys on the wall. You'd be like, what am I doing here? You know? So I'm like, no, just you'll be okay. Just they took some still pictures of me and stuff like that. And then 2 weeks after, I had a casting for a beauty campaign, but I was supposed to be like a supporting role for this woman,
yeah,
in a TV commercial. So I went there, and I was supposed to wear a suit. They were looking for a man, you know, like. And I was young, but the fact that the way I used to carry myself, and I think, as I said, I grew up very fast because I never really knew better as a child. So things were just happening. And I went to this casting, but I didn't have a suit. I didn't have formal shoes. You had to wear a tuxedo, and I've never owned a tuxedo. So I had to make some calls and help. I asked some guys from school, like, can you please borrow me some shoes? And I'll bring it straight after my casting. This is an opportunity, and so on. So somebody gave me a jacket. It was a little bit loose, but it fit. And another person gave me some shoes, and I looked nice. I look a bit decent. It was a hot day. I had to walk again to my casting. I remember my casting number was 3025. I went in there, and they say, you had to perform, you know, this, you really care for this woman, and she was supposed to do a part, and I improv per se. I did it, and I left there, I was nervous. You can see the guys, they're tall, muscular, they go to the gym, they eat well, and whatever. I'm just a nobody. A week went by, I booked that campaign. And it was one of the biggest campaign of 2010.
The advertising campaign.
Advertising for a beauty product called Pond's.
And that's what you did the commercial for?
I did the commercial for them. Yeah. So from there, I got to a place where my face was everywhere. I was really fortunate to take part in such a campaign, and my face was everywhere. There were advertising like
Billboards,
billboards,
TV.
TV. I shot two episodes. They flew me to the UK. So it was
Wow.
it was, and I was 19,
Wow.
19, yeah. They flew me to the UK, and from there, even the money that I had, I think it was a conditioning. Off of that money went to my family. And my family was so used to a point where
You mean your
it's
family as in your uncle?
my uncle, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. You're still sending them your money.
All right. So I was like, that's off of that. You can start something, a little business, and whatever. So there's this fish business, and until today, I'm trying to see if wherever I'm gonna go, if I could get some money and I could help them sort that out. But I gave them that money, and that money, the way it finished, I have no idea. I didn't really enjoy most of my money anyway. I just got some clothes and whatever. And I think the agency that's signed me up, I was gonna get paid a lot of money, but they were not being honest.
They were taking a lot of the money.
I think they took about 60%
You
of,
got this kid, he don't know what's going on.
So,
Imagine that, dishonest people. You don't see that every
So
day.
it happened. I think I got like maybe 30% of the money that was paid to me. But for
Wow.
me, it was a life changer because now people knew me. People knew my name. People would like to, and they were advertising like if you buy this, you go on dates with this guy or whatever the case was, So it's kind of built a momentum where I was like, you know what, I can do this. I can do this. And I started, it's kind of boost up my confidence. Then I went to another casting, then I went to another, and it became part of my normal routine. They saw that, and then I started being aware of the entertainment industry and so on and so forth, to a place where I booked a lot of jobs. I was doing a lot of TV commercials, but I was still getting some money, and I have to do this, I have to do this. I've always been the parent, but to a large degree, I always say I'm thankful to them, to my uncle and his wife, because they've been there, and I don't have any other parents.
I gotta ask you, did she ever apologize for beating you up?
No.
Not to this day. And
Not.
you're still being their parents now, basically.
Yeah.
You're a pretty good guy.
I'm at the moment, she've never apologized. So she, I don't know. That's why I'm always thanking God. Like, I don't know how to be mean to her. Because I don't know. I think God has given me that heart to just, I let her be to a large degree.
You keep mentioning God. Tell me what's your faith? I mean, would people label you as a Christian, or would they label you as a this, or how
Okay.
would you label
And
yourself?
for me, it's a very very interesting question. And I would say I was born in a Christian home. So I am of Christian faith, but at the same time, I do not always comply and abide by the way they do things. I'm a strong believer. I think the more I'm growing older, I'm becoming aware of my surroundings and things that is happening, is that faith is something that we have inside of us. And you find people that they call themselves, they label themselves, I'm Jew, I'm Hindu, I'm this, I'm that. But it's all come to an ultimate thing. They believe in a higher power. So regardless of my religion, regardless of who I am, if I believe that there is, for me, I say God, there's a higher power that is in control of everything that I've ever known. I am where I am today. It's not by myself or my power. I don't think I'll survive this long. I wish I can draw the picture of, I've seen dead people. I've seen people killing each other. I've walked in a place where there's lions, for crying out loud. And I've crossed borders as a child. That does not make me like I'm a super being. There's something that is more powerful than what it is. I do understand that there's religion, but the way we go about religion now, I don't think it's a right way. It becomes just a label. Faith is shown by doing things. When you believe in the unseen, when you believe in something that you don't know, for me, I call that faith. If I believe that ever since I was a child, I had this strong belief that one day I can do better. Even when I was still in the village, I still saw myself in South Africa, where I could sit with other people and talk to them and be somewhere. It's something that I believed in, something that I didn't know.
So help me now. You're doing great. You're getting booked for lots of jobs. Why do you give it up?
This is where things became very difficult. South Africa. South Africa, they had this xenophobia things going on.
Xenophobia.
Yes, sir. So I've been trying to get better, to do things well. But whenever that, if you're not South African, you are limited. I cannot go to the bank and say,
this is something familiar.
Yeah. Yeah. So if I don't, I waited almost 10 years. I've applied and applied in South Africa. I was a refugee in South Africa for all this time where I was booking jobs.
You became legal at some point.
Yes, I was a legal refugee in South Africa.
How did that happen since you illegally came in?
So you go and apply, and then they go through the process, they go through interviews and whatever.
You admit you came in illegally.
Yeah, I admit that. I came in South Africa illegally. And then, because my uncle, when he was there, he already applied for me in advance.
Oh, okay.
So he applied that this guy will be coming, but
he'll be coming in illegally, and I want to go ahead and apply.
There we go. That's what happened. And when we got to a place where the xenophobia thing, there was no growth for me in South Africa. You make a little bit of money, and it just disappear. You, rent, it's off the roof because you're not South African.
Everything's more expensive.
Everything is more,
South African.
Yes. Even your bank account. At some point, I couldn't open a bank account when I was a refugee. When I became a permanent resident, which I am now in South Africa, after all this time I've been in South Africa, I only became a permanent resident, I think, about 3 years ago.
Couldn't have a bank account. Couldn't have. Your rent was higher. They're basically basic. Non-residents pay more.
Non-resident, you, even getting a car, you cannot say, I'll finance something. You can't.
Everything's cash.
And then, if you live in a world where they do have banks, you gotta have some form of credit to get you by. If you don't, you have nothing.
So you finally get legal status, but even then...
Even then, when you're permanent resident in the country, there's just still something you cannot do.
Racism still?
Racism, for me, I think South Africa, there is some form of racism, but I think South African people that are born in South Africa, they've gotten to a place where they're just ignorant now. They've taken racism as they went overboard with it. You know, I'm talking from a point where I am a refugee. And this is an advice that I'll give to anybody. Like, I came from a place where I was a refugee. I went through everything, but there was some level of success that came with everything that I did. Why? It's not about what I did. It's not about some kind of stunt that I pulled, but it's learning to do things in a certain way. And that certain way, most ignorant people are not qualified. They don't want to qualify for that. They want things to be ended over.
I see.
Like, okay, the white man killed this. There are people that are talking politics that they don't even know. They were born yesterday. They have no idea.
Don't even know what they're talking
They don't
about.
Even know what they're talking about. But they're so passionate about something that they're not aware of. So it becomes a cycle. Sometimes I've been going to debates because I'm at the place where I would like to write my story. I'm a terrible writer, and I would like to write my story and put it in a book, and also create it as a tool not to make people pity my life, but as a tool to also help young people, because I'm still young and I'm still searching for that happiness. I wanna get a family, I wanna have children, but I'm not letting circumstances stop me from what I'm. Here I am. I'm in America. This is a dream. It's like when I went on my knees and I cried to be here. It's. I don't know what's awaiting for me. I have no idea. I wish, and I'm trying so hard, and I want to help my family so much. I want to do whatever I can to help them, because I see the condition that they live. I see.
You say it was a dream. When did the dream begin?
I remember when I was doing a little bit of more acting, but I was not getting paid for what I was worth. I was still struggling. As much as I was a permanent resident in South Africa, there was just some stuff. You're like, no, they can't do it for you. They cannot do this. They cannot do ABC. But every American that I've met, or every person that have been in America, they still believed in the American dream. They still believe that this is the land of opportunity. If you do things the right way, you're going to get what you want, and you're going to go forward from that. Everybody from the third world, we still believe in the idea of the American dream.
So how did you go about getting to America?
So I went to, America has this program called DV program. So you apply online and you give them your information, and so they kind of do a background check and say you would like to relocate to America, and they'll ask you questions. Why would you want to be in America? And so you go through a process of a survey, and you fill it up online, and then they'll take those applications. They'll enter them in a draw. So it's like a lottery.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You won the lottery.
I won the lottery. So that's why I say my life has been a consistent blessing. And I want to share that with everybody and get to a place where I want to be successful. And I know I'll get there someday. It might not now be now, but I will get there. I want to share my story and get to a place where I use my story to motivate and inspire other people.
How did you end up in Texas?
Texas, I've got an uncle. Well, from my, I call him grandpa, uncle. Sometimes there's a lot of confusion because I don't know a lot of things about my family, because I've been just everywhere. So this is my step, well, my uncle's wife, which I call mother, uncle. So her uncle relocated here 15 years ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So he's a truck driver. And then when he heard that I won the lottery, I haven't been in touch with him in a long time. And again, in order for you to come, even if you have the lottery, I spent every dollar that I had to make this happen, because you have to do medical checkups, you have to go through interview, and the interview, it's in another city. I have to fly there to make sure that I go for the interview.
In South Africa.
I had to make sure that I pay for my flight. So every money that I had, I put it together to make sure that I get my... If all those process, you fail any of those process, you cannot enter America. So I had to do everything by the book. There is a legal way to do things, because I was also doing research. America is built on a foundation of, it's got people from all over the world, and that's what makes America great. And, but do it in a proper way. Come in legally. And for me, I think I would say it because I've been in a place where each country protect itself.
You've done a little illegal.
I've done that, and I've learned a great lesson, and it's at supreme importance that people, you know, we just do things right. So I had to spend every bucket, every dollar that I had to make those papers and whatever.
You and I talked about this a lot the other day. What would you say to me and other Americans? You know, there's a, let's just face it, there's a little bit of an attitude right now of don't need no more immigrants in here. What would you say to people who say, enough, we don't want no more of these people coming in?
For me, I think they'll be taking the America for what it stands for what everybody knows America to be. They'll be taking that power away, because America, it's its people. And I don't think, if you go down the line and the history, I don't know, maybe the Indians were the American Americans, you know, but if
really know what illegal immigration can do.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So if we go and say, I'm not an American, you are not an American, then I would say maybe 70% of the country is not American. So they have to be aware of set rules. And I just went through the process. There are rules.
Was it tough?
It is tough. It's not. Here's the thing. There's no shortcut if you want to do things right. There isn't a shortcut. You will spend a little bit of money. You will, if you want to live in another country, it shouldn't be a problem. Any country per se, not only America. I do understand that America got to protect those people, but it's people from the other country that also boost the economy. It's people that also spend the money in the country. They also pay taxes. But what I'm going to say is that illegally, it's not okay. You cannot enter the country illegally, but you cannot stop people from migrating. Because I had a girlfriend from Chicago. She decided to stay in South Africa. She went about it the right way. You know, so any people should have that free will of, I can travel, and America should have that in place, because it's built on that foundation. Yeah. It's built on that ground that you are welcome. America is welcome. Even on the Statue of Liberty, it says America is still built on the foundation of immigrant. So if, as American, you don't know that that's what makes America great, you cannot make America great than what it is. That's where I don't understand what the president was trying to say. I'm not going to fight and say whatever, because I might not know what... this is my opinion.
America's great to you.
For me, America has always been great. It's built on that foundation. You come here, you work hard, you'll make it. And everybody that I've encountered, everybody that I met, and people that I've... And these are foreigners. It's like, The American dream still exists, but you cannot take that away. When you do take it away, then what is America? Then it becomes just like any other country.
Shh, it's okay.
You know, then it becomes just like any...
Lay this over here for a minute. If it'll stay there. Probably just delivering something. Very good. Thank you.
All right.
Sorry about that.
No, it's okay.
I always get excited when I hear somebody outside the door.
Yeah. It's okay. So yeah, anyway, so...
What you're saying is that you see America was your dream. It's a great place.
It's
and the way to keep it great is... Don't close the borders.
Don't close doors. For me, I always say, you know, you can do things past a certain point. America has been existing all these years with foreigners. So, what issues did you have? Fine. There are people, that, there are things that maybe I'm not aware of. Drug dealers or people that are doing illegal businesses or whatever the case may be, shut those things down, but put it in a way that not everybody is bad.
Do you want to become a citizen?
I would love to become a citizen in America. I would. At some point, I would love to become a citizen of the United States. And for me, from what I've gathered, despite everything that has been happening with the elections and everything, it's scary because I don't know where I'm standing right now. Tomorrow they can say, pack your bags and go. And I'm like, where do I go to? I don't know. South Africa, they're still killing us. So where do I go? I don't have a place to go.
Did you get worried? You came here 2 months ago.
Yeah.
What date did you come?
I would say the interview process, I still need to check the date. It's been like 2 months or 3 months ago.
So it was
around
after the election or before the election?
It was before the election.
Okay. Were you a little bit worried?
Yeah.
Thinking something could happen?
Yeah.
Whatever.
It was still before the election. I was like, God, I don't want to get in a plane and say... And then on top of that, one of my fear, because I'm not a citizen of South Africa, I'm a Congolese citizen. Congo back, because I've never been, I haven't been.
You're not welcome back.
Yeah, I don't know anything about Congo per se.
Wow.
So now I got, what is this? A travel document.
Uh-huh.
Now there are certain passports that you cannot travel with. So I don't have the green passport from South Africa. I've got a black passport. So I was worried, like, what if I get to the airport to say we can't accept? Now, the visa, they only give it to me for a certain period of time. In order for me to get my green card, I have to be in the country at a certain date.
And right now you have a visa for the U.S.?
Yeah, I've got the visa for the U.S.
How long is it good for?
My visa was for 1 year. And then my green card, I've got a 10-year green
visa. Oh, you have a 10-year
green card.
So as long as you work,
yeah,
you're good for 10 years.
Yeah, so I'm a permanent resident for now.
Cool.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So I'm a permanent resident in the United States. As again, those things are in place, do it the right way. And this is for Americans. And I think this, even for South African, and it's something that I've come to understand, is that when you're comfortable with certain things, it's become your comfort zone. And then you find yourself, you don't want to work. And I come here to do whatever it is that I have to do. If I have to clean the toilets, I'll do it.
You want to work.
I want to work. I'm a strong believer. This is that's always kept me going, is that our rewards in life will always be in exact proportion to our contribution of service. There's no such thing as something for nothing. You put in the work, you get rewarded. It might not be an instant reward, but you will get rewarded at some point in your life, you will.
Do you think ourselves, just you've been here just 2-3 months, what's your observation? Do you think you don't know me personally, I'll just say, do you think we Americans realize how good we've got it?
No, I don't.
Do you think we realize how bad some people have it?
No, we don't. I work in a restaurant, my very first job here in America. At the moment, I'm in the process of training at Olive Garden where we met. Things that people will kill and fight for every day, and things that my family is still fighting for in Africa. They're still struggling to get the next meal. If I make $20, I have to send them $10 to get food. But in the restaurant, they take trays and trays of food and chuck it in the trash.
Does that hurt you to see that?
It bothers me. It's like you're living in the land of milk and honey, and yet you are complaining about. Even when I call home, I speak to my family. I tell them, like, things that we place value in Africa, it's not the same. At home, everybody can get the place to stay. Food, everybody get fed.
Here.
Yeah, in America, everybody get fed.
For granted.
Everybody get fed. Car. A 16-year-old get a car. I got a car, I don't know. You know, I walked to school miles and miles away. I got wet. I stole trains, you know. And again, some people are fortunate than the other, but that should not be an excuse to, you can't complain about those things.
You know, I'll tell you a quick story too. I got a lot of great stuff here, and I do want to take pictures of your pictures in a minute. It's kind of funny. I hear people sometimes nowadays, and I get a little bit tickled. They say, you must laugh if you hear this, but they'll say, I tell you, kids nowadays have it so tough. They'll say that they have it so tough. I even told somebody one time, I said, let me tell you my knowledge of a little bit of what tough is. My great-grandmother, when she was in a family of 5 kids, when she was like 13, her parents, they lived on a farm in Central Texas, and her parents died in a house fire. And the only help that she got was the neighbors brought over and set up a tent for all seasons. And she raised the kids. As a 13-year-old, she became the parent of the family.
Wow.
And raised the kids. And my great-grandfather on that side